So I'm very happy to welcome our speaker today, who is a former colleague of most of ours here at NIH and has also previously worked at CDC and now is in Melbourne, Australia, currently a parasitologist and ID consultant at the Peter Doherty Institute at the University of Melbourne. And has a special interest in parasitic diseases and tropical medicine and an interest in traveler's health. He's also a consultant at the Royal Melbourne Hospital, the main teaching and referral hospital at the University of Melbourne. He has a research interest in malaria, but also, as a lot of people are, also doing some work in the immunobiology of SARS-CoV-2. And we're very happy to have him talk about a topic that they see much more than we do over in Australia, but is still remains very important and even more so in recent news in the US. So he's gonna talk about melioidosis. It's in the soil. So with that, take it away, Siddharth. Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you. Can everyone hear me? I hope, yes, still, yes. Okay, thank you very much for the kind introduction, Elise. It's nice to see faces that I've seen before and places that I've seen before. That's very nice to visit, even if it's virtual. So just by way of disclaimer, I'm going to be talking about something that Australia is a big continent, and we actually, there are areas, things that you see in one area is not necessarily commonly seen in other parts of the country. So melioidosis is a resident of the northern half of Australia. We almost never see it in the southern half where Melbourne is. So a lot of my experience has been from referred cases and not so much from primary diagnosis. However, I'm going to try and give a little overview of the disease through cases and publications that have come out from Australia. And it is it's not a peculiarly Australian disease, but Australians have sort of cornered the market in a little bit on reportage on it. So I'll come back to the title, but I've called this melioidosis, it's in the soil. Oops, there we go. So I think, I think it's a pure coincidence, but it's very timely that we are having a discussion about this disease, because very recently there's been reporting of this so-called rare infectious disease in the US, when there was a cluster of cases reported by the CDC in October, where they identified the bacteria that responsible for Burkholderia in a scattering of cases that were all linked to one particular aromatherapy spray, which was made by Better Homes and Gardens. And I think people may have heard about these cases. The genomic analysis of these four cases showed that they matched very closely and were very likely a common source. And the isolates that they sequenced grouped with the South Asian strains. So it's been introduced somehow from the Indian subcontinent. The range of illnesses, there were four cases and two deaths. So it was quite severe in terms of its case fatality rate. The illnesses that the individuals presented with were fever, nausea, vomiting. In two cases, there were skin rashes. And I think three out of the four had pneumonia. And only two of them had underlying comorbidities that would have made them more susceptible. So this is quite unusual, but if you look back at the CDC numbers, it's actually, you get about 12 cases reported a year in the US. So it's not an insignificant amount that is reported in the US. And the US is not the, The US is not the only place outside in the non-tropical world that has reported this. There's regular reports of cases, fewer than in the US, but nevertheless, a small number, handful of cases every year in Europe, amongst usually amongst travelers or immigrants. And there was a review done a couple of years ago, which counted up 77 cases between 2000 and 2018. The breakdown of cases was about 50% were discovered when they came in bacteremic, and 100% of the fatal cases were bacteremic, and about 53% of the cases had returned from Thailand, returned travelers from Thailand, and 60% of those had holidayed for, I can't see the, just 1 second, sorry. Had stayed for less than a month in Thailand. Had holiday stayed, but 25% of them had stayed for less than a month. The presentations were fairly typical of this illness. Half of them presented with pneumonias, and cardiovascular disease was present in about 45%, and skin manifestations in 23%. In terms of treatment outcome, this table actually was, sorry, it's very sensitive here. I'm going back, trying to get back here. Yeah, okay. This table here summarizes the comorbidities that were found in the European cases, and about 20% each had diabetes, chronic lung diseases, or liver disease, chronic liver disease. And 10%, 8 to 10% had immunosuppression as the comorbidity. And that's a point I might get back to at the end if we have time. So I'm going to start with a couple of illustrative cases to give you a flavor of the disease. And then we'll talk a little bit about the epidemiology and the pathogenesis and the management of the infection, which has been fairly protocolized in Australia because they see enough of the cases. So the first case I'm going to talk about is a 75-year-old man who presented with a chronic non-healing ulcer in his left lower leg. His past history was somewhat unusual because apart from his tonsillectomy, it had been diagnosed with psittacosis 30 years ago and had continued to keep his pet cockatoo, which, by the way, has a very, very long lifespans, 30 to 50 years. The social context was that he was a frequent traveler. He was a retired Qantas pilot, but currently, or the time when he presented, he lived in Northern Territory, about 3 hours southwest of Darwin. With his wife. He owned an ecotourism business, so he was out in the bush a lot, and he was an occasional drinker and a non-smoker. Importantly, he had no recent travel within the past year of when he presented, and the last overseas travel was to Canada 8 years prior to this presentation. The history of his current issue illness was that he had an injury to his left anterior leg from what they call a whippersnapper, which is those little the wire lawnmower, handheld lawnmower devices, 2 years ago. And that had been slow to heal. But a month before presentation, he scratched that old injury site and broke the skin. And of course, he was ecotourism, so he was walking through all the water logged land, and his wound continued to increase in size, ultimately ulcerating, and then was associated with erythema. And you can see what it looked like when we saw him in referral from his GP. He visited his son in Townsville, and his son arranged for a wound swab, but there was no growth. And then his daughter lived in Melbourne. So when he was visiting her, he went to his local medical officer, who prescribed 2 courses of cephalexin, but sure had no improvement in the wound. And the wound, when we saw him, was a non-tender 3x5 centimeter ulcerated lesion with a surrounding erythema. The GP arranged for a repeat wound swab and a biopsy, and he referred us, him to the infectious disease clinic. A gram stain was done at our clinic, which showed gram positive cocci and gram negative cocci, skin bacteria essentially. And we were waiting for the culture, trying to figure out what was going on, why it had not responded. This is redundant here. This is meant for a different situation, but basically we went through the differential of the common infections, and the Haemophilus is thrown in as a distractor. But we, because of his location of his home and his occupation, we did have Burkholderia pseudomallei in mind as one of the potential causes. And sure enough, on culture, there was moderate growth of a gram for the negative or a gram variable rod, which was identified as Burkholderia pseudomallei. So on further history, when after we got that result back, we did more questioning, and he reported that he'd had 2 weeks of urinary frequency and urgency, but no systemic symptoms, no coughs, no chest symptoms. And on examination, it was essentially a normal exam. He did have a slightly enlarged prostate, but he's 75 years old and it was not incompatible with his age. Labs were essentially normal. There was no sign of inflammation. His CRP was 2, and blood cultures were negative, which is an important point, which, as we will see later. The urine, because of his symptoms, we sent off a urine. It showed 2 leukocytes, no growth, and no nitrates, and no significant bleeding or blood cells. And the prostate function or prostate screen was negative. So at this point, I don't know if anyone wants to guess at or suggest what else should we be doing now that we know what the culture result is. I'll give people a moment to answer if they want to. Okay, I guess I'll keep going.
Guess we don't know.
Well, the point here was just that we should be doing a screen for other distant sites for infection. Having some trouble.
Sure, I thought there. I don't know if you're hinting at the prostate. I know there's an association with prostatic abscess, but yes. I don't know if this is enough to.
That was part of it. Yes, exactly. Let me just go to the. I'm having some trouble moving my slides forward. I'm not sure why. Okay, so we did the point here was that we have to look for disseminated disease in this situation, and the commonest sites are the lung, the bone, and the prostate. And so we imaged all of these, and in this particular case, there was no sign of an abscess in the prostate, and the lungs were clear, and there was no bone lesions. This is just an example of one of the bones, because he had the infection in that foot, we wanted to make sure it hadn't gone deeper. So what we had here was an infection with Burkholderia pseudomallei, and this is called melioidosis. And the term melioidosis is taken from Greek melis, or distemper of asses. It was first described by Whitmore in 1911 as a septicemic disease in morphine addicts in Rangoon, in Myanmar. He described a small facultative intracellular gram-negative bacillus. And this is gram negative in most situations, but can also be gram variable in some isolations. And this is what it looks like on colony morphology. On the left, you've got some special agar. Please don't ask me what goes into it. We call it Ashdown's agar. And on the right is human blood agar. And it grows in both and forms these coalescing mucoid colonies. And on gram stain, this particular one, in this particular gram stain, it's looking almost gram positive, but the typical appearance is that of the safety pin. Look, it's got the two blobs at the ends that makes it look like a safety pin. The transmission is of this infection is through inhalation, ingestion, or percutaneous inoculation, although percutaneous is considered the most common way in which you get infected. And it's acquired most commonly through contaminated soil or surface water. So damp soil or swamps are where you'd expect this to be much more commonly present. And in fact, there's been a few studies looking at isolation of Burkholderia from soils in different parts of the world. And one of these, which I've got a photo of here, is from the US, showing that there's no evidence of pseudomelia in this particular screen. But there have been others that have reported the presence of Burkholderia in almost any areas where they've looked within the subtropical and tropical regions. So that's where I put the title, it's in the soil, because if it's in the soil, it's likely to, the similar soils will support growth of this persistence of this organism wherever they are in the world. And then another good example of that one actually is Mycobacterium abscessus, which is also associated with certain types of soil, and that type of soil is only found in Southeast Australia and in Western Africa, Central Western Africa, and that's where you get the Buruli ulcer or the abscessus ulcers that we call them here. So there is a precedence for soil-associated occurrence or epidemiology of bacterial infections. Burkholderia migrates to the surface of the soil in wet season. And so very often there's clusters of infections in the wet season, which in Darwin lasts from November to April. And you'll often see, and I'll show you one example where you'll see waves of infection, not waves, but clusters of infection occurring during the wet season only. This organism infects humans and animals, and it's been reported from a whole variety of animals, of domestic animals, ranging from sheep to kangaroos, and it's even been isolated from crocodiles. Not surprisingly. So there is a changing epidemiology, and this is presumed to be because of the effect of climate change. But there's more areas now that are showing evidence of Burkholderia persistence or isolation than there were in even 10, 15 years ago. And there's this particular map made by Simon Hay, modeled by Simon Hay, predicts where the highest concentration of Burkholderia would be based on their soil characteristics now in the next 10 years. And you can see that there's areas that are going to increase. So for example, in Africa, there's Western Africa is predicted to have a lot more and more involvement of this or isolation of this organism from the soil. The clinical features are there's distinct syndromes that presentation that result in presentation, and I've sort of broken them up into the different presentations or syndromes that you can identify or divide the patients into. There's a localized infection, and this is usually results in localized pain or swelling in one of the limbs. They often report fever, ulceration, and that was our case one, was the ulcerated ulceration and localized pain, but he didn't have as much pain as many other patients that I've seen or heard of have. And they can get skin abscesses. And this is about 25% of the presentations are in this category. The most common category actually is the pulmonary infection, which is more more invasive. And it people present with cough, chest pain, fever, often very high fever, headaches, anorexia, just exactly what you expect with the pneumonia. And they get a nodular pneumonia, and sometimes they get an interstitial ground glass type of appearance in their lungs when they present with more aggressive disease. The next serious level of disease is bloodstream infection. And this is a septicemic disease with fever, headaches, often ARDS or respiratory distress, lots of abdominal symptoms, and they can even get joint pains from Arthur's reaction type of antibody reaction to deposition in the joints. And they can often be disoriented, but that has to be distinguished from CNS involvement. This is more likely due to the sepsis and the toxin that are circulating, which I'll mention in a minute. And the final and most serious form of infection is the disseminated infection, and these individuals present with fever, weight loss, often with stomach or chest pain, lots of systemic joints and muscle pains. And if the CNS gets involved, they often get an abscess, CNS, brain abscess, and that can result in seizures. So there was about 2 months ago, there was a review published of a very long prospective study that was set up in Darwin. And the map here shows the region of Australia where these infections are most commonly found, which is up in the north. They call it the top end. And this was published by Bart Curry, who's a renowned expert in this disease. And they looked back over 30 years. They started recording or enrolling patients because they have such a very good, very small number of individuals, and in the territory, they're able to follow all the infections, and there's a single health service. They're able to trace all the infections, and they tracked all the infections that were reported between 1918, I think it was 1989 and 2019, a 30-year period. And this was published in Lancet ID. And some of the data there is very interesting. So they had almost 1,148 culture-confirmed cases with a 12% mortality. The cases correlated with the amount of rainfall that year. And they had a graph, which I'll show you in a minute. And 80% of infections occurred during the wet season, exactly as had been reported before by the other investigators. Genotyping of this pseudomallei confirmed the case clusters to be linked to environmental sources and defined an evolving and new sequence types, but this only has been occurring in the last 5 to 10 years. So here is the link where they're showing the link between rainfall amounts and infections. If you look on the left, there's a it's a busy slide, busy plot, but the important thing to note is that this solid line here is the total incidence per population, per 100,000 population, and you're getting some waves of infection that happen in years that where the rainfall is also the highest. The case numbers go up. The rainfall is shown in the dotted line, and you can see that there's a general correlation between the amount of rainfall and the height of the clusters of the cases. And marked in here are weather events, significant weather events, where there's natural disasters or cyclones. And in each of those situations, they're trying to see, they found several of those large disruptions associated with a cluster of infections occurring right soon after or right at the around the same time. And the other interesting thing is shown here, which is the difference between the rates of infection in indigenous versus non-indigenous populations. And the indigenous populations are rural, they live very much closer to land and in areas where there's few roads. So they get exposed much more, and that probably explains some of the differences. But what you can see here is that the indigenous population has quite a significantly higher rate per 100,000 population compared to the non-indigenous population. And there's much more variability there, depending on the environment and weather. Their breakdown of clinical presentations was essentially what's been reported before, which is 50% pneumonia, about 15% skin, a little lower than has been reported for skin, and genital urinary and bacteremia alone accounted for about 10% of the cases. And septic shock was quite common in the pneumonic group, but not so in the other groups as you'd expect. The death rate was about 12% total, but those that had pneumonia had a higher rate, and those that had the skin infections generally had a lower death rate, which is not a real surprise. They also looked at the risk factors that fell out with the infections, and as has been reported before, diabetes was the number one comorbidity, and number two was liver, and then chronic lung disease and renal disease, and the other factors, including immunosuppressive therapy and immunosuppression. One of the questions that this has raises is how are changes in the coming 20, 30 years in environment or in demography going to affect the incidence or the prevalence of melioidosis? And this article written a year ago tries to do some predictions, and what they're doing here is to show you the predicted percentage of diabetics in 2030, so in 10 years time from now, but over a 30-year period, the increase was projected with using modeling, and what they found was that the environmental suitability interacts with that increased rates of diabetes in Brazil and in Southeast Asia to probably give big large hotspots of infection, and in India as well, hotspots of infection would be expected to occur in these areas because of the intersection of the demography and the environmental changes from climate change. In terms of diagnosis, it's, as I mentioned earlier, the primary diagnosis is usually made by bacteriology, and it's fairly easy to grow. It's not a fastidious organism, but you have to be thinking about it, or you don't, or you get surprised by its isolation. There have been some serological tests that have been developed, and in fact, there's even a rapid ICT type test for IgG antibodies and IgM antibodies that have been tested, but their sensitivity and specificity are not, particularly sensitivity is not that good for the rapid test. However, the ELISA test, particularly the recombinant antigen test, have shown a fair amount of promise. So these three here are the recombinant HCP or Gruel antigen ELISAs, and they show sensitivities of 90% and specificity of 89%. And these have been developed in Thailand and are used on a fairly regular basis there for to assist in diagnosis. There's a lot that's been learned in terms of the pathogenesis, but I'm just going to touch on a few aspects of it. The risk factors, as we said, are identified already, and the diabetes alone gives you a risk ratio of about 20 to 1. And this is consistent with all the studies that have been done, not just in Australia. The incubation period is about 21 days on average, 1 to 21 days, 9 days on average, 1 to 21 days. But there have been reports of latent infection declaring itself decades after travel to the endemic area. So this is an interesting persistence story. The pathogenesis is dependent on some toxins that are produced by the bacteria, and they have been identified to be present in the membranes as well as in the cytoplasm of the bacteria. And this schematic here just shows the life cycle of the life cycle of the bacteria, I guess, as it enters the host. And it's an intracellular host, organisms sort of like tuberculosis or salmonella. And so there's a secretion system that allows its proteins to be excreted up, excreted to the cytoplasm and then out through the periplasmic membrane. There's a tendency to form these multinucleated giant cells, and that allows the organism to travel freely between adjacent cells. And these molecules that are numbered here, like VGR, G, and HCP, and these have been studied for their biochemical toxin effects and found to be fairly toxic to mammalian cells. The identified virulence factors that are expressed in this bacteria include the LPS series, LPS A, B, and D2. And this helps to evade host defenses in early infection associated with the biofilm formation. FHAB3 is a filamentous hemagglutinin gene, and this allows it to adhere to the epithelial cells and is associated with the cutaneous form of the disease, expression of this toxin, I mean. And BIM-A is the Burkholderia intracellular motility. It's a seems to be associated with neurological disease and it's an independent risk factor for infection of the brain. Management, so this has been, as I mentioned, protocolized, and in Australia, there's essentially two sort of guides that are used. One is called the therapeutic guides, and the electronic version is called the ETG, and this spells out the dose and the options for treatment, which is very useful for GPs and for the non-experts. But the treatment strategy is basically a two-stage treatment. There's an initial intensive phase of therapy for 2 weeks, and then what they call an eradication phase, which can be last for from 3 to 12 months, depending on the severity of the disease. And it seems that this, it seems that the 2 weeks, even though they become abacterial, non-bacteremic, and should start showing some signs of healing, if you stop at that period, there's relapse in a very large proportion of cases. The type of infection does decide what course of treatment, how long a course of treatment you will choose. And generally, the more invasive the disease, the longer the course of the treatment. Even the initial phase is increased to 8 weeks if there's neurological disease. The more recent and probably more extended, more detailed and better guide is one that was developed at the top end, which is Northern Australia, around Darwin area, by the health service services of NT, Northern Territory. And they call the TEHS guidelines for treatment of melioidosis. And this spells out essentially the phase, the duration of the treatment for each of the different each of the different disease types. How am I doing with time, Elise?
You have 20 more minutes until.
Okay, good.
We're over so with time.
I'll go quickly through this case because then we can wrap up and have sure. Some time for questions. So the second case is a slightly different presentation. It's a 58-year-old female who presented with abdominal pain and fevers and polyarthralgia. She lives on a property outside Darwin, and the story was that she's been watching storms on her veranda during the wet season. So she was out and exposed quite a bit. And she was diagnosed with diabetes within the last year and had been put on metformin. So again, this leads to the recognition of comorbidities there. She came in quite sick and actually was thought to be in septic shock. So she was admitted to ICU with vasopressor support and oxygen. And she was found to have generalized but mild abdominal tenderness. But her left wrist and knee and both the ankles were swollen and tender. She was commenced empirically on what they call wet season severe sepsis antibiotics, which is meropenem and vancomycin. The meropenem is specifically meant for to also cover burkholderia in that setting in the top end. The knee aspirate was aspirated, and the aspirate showed no crystals, but neutrophils of 90,000 and erythrocytes, so there was blood in it as well, 24,000, low amount of blood. But 24 hours later, the blood culture done on admission came back positive for a motile bipolar staining gram-negative bacillus. So we had the diagnosis there. And this is the urine analysis. Sorry, the synovial fluid analysis, which I think I just went over. her lungs were imaged, and what we see here are the coronal CT chest on the lung window, which shows the multiple nodules. You can see both peripheral and central, and what was reported, the ground glass appearance consistent with pulmonary involvement of Burkholder area. She was also found to have, on CT scan of the abdomen, she was found to have abscesses or filling defects in the kidneys, and also the splenic pole, south, the lower pole of the spleen. And an MRI of the right ankle showed increased hyperintensity around the talus and calcaneum, which is consistent with osteomyelitis, which was thought to be consistent with osteomyelitis. So she had involvement of the bone, the lung, and the kidneys and spleen. So she had disseminated disease, and she was put on IV meropenem until she was stabilized, and then changed to ceftazidime for the intensive treatment phase. And after 4 weeks, she was changed over to trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, which is the eradication phase treatment. But she required multiple surgical washouts of the affected joints, and the abscesses eventually resolved, but they took several months to resolve. She had a long hospitalization, including the rehab, and made a slow recovery, but took almost 12 months to get back to independent living. So this can be quite a devastating disease. And then just a few quick snapshots of other types of presentations. So here's a male with the amyloidosis who is presented with the prostatic abscess shown by the arrow here, occupying half of the prostate. And this is a different male with multi-prostatic, as you can see, he's got prostatic abscess. The arrow seems to have slipped. And he's also got a brain abscess, which was found to be positive for Burkholderia on biopsy. This is a different course, a different case, where I've just shown you the complexity of the treatment in this timeline, where the patient was a return traveler from Thailand in his late 40s, maybe late 50s actually. And he was rushed back to Australia because he collapsed in Thailand while he was on his holiday. And he was medevaced back to Australia, where he was admitted to a hospital. He was started on the broad spectrum antibiotics, and when the blood culture turned positive on day 8, he was switched over to meropenem alone, and then on to IV Bactrim after 3 weeks. But throughout this period, he continued to have I forgot to mention, he was on immunosuppressive therapy throughout his early stage, and he didn't show any real improvement. But eventually, he became confused and delirious. And there was questions about whether there was a device infection. But after a whole bunch of interventions, eventually he did respond to the Bactrim, and he required transurethral resection of the prostate as part of his management. So he ended up spending more than 6 months in and out of hospital. So it can be a very devastating disease and time. So the more recent trend now is to try and use dual therapy and to try and eradicate as soon as you start treatment or during the intensive phase itself. And there's been two randomized controlled trials that have shown promise for this type of treatment for clearing the disease without having to do long-term eradication. So this is probably the way of the future. So just to summarize, I think this is my last slide. Melioidosis, the key points are that this is a globally distributed infection of humans and animals, and it occurs, it persists in the soil as well as in animal populations. It's an emerging infection with evolving endemicity, and in the context of the US, probably the most important population to focus on are the returned travelers. Treatment involves a short initial and a long eradication phase of treatment of antibiotics. The intensive phase usually requires ceftazidime or meropenem, and the eradication phase requires Bactrim, and this can be as long as 12 months of continuous treatment. And there's been some suggestion that those that are very susceptible and in living in the environment where they could get infection, you might consider primary prophylaxis. And there's been one publication that from Northern Australia that suggested that primary prophylaxis can prevent relapse and even maybe prevent infection. So I'll stop there, except I do want to thank my colleagues who shared their cases with me and helped with the management of the cases, particularly Dr. Uli Shi and Dr. Ian Jennings, both infectious disease consultants, and the other ward teams that looked after the patients while they were in the ward. I think I'll stop. That's the last slide. Let me stop sharing. And I will.
Thanks, Siddharth. Great. We have just a few comments, and people can continue to put any questions or comments they have in the chat. I guess the first question raised was just about the 62-year incubation period or relapse period you mentioned. So Annika Klein, who's familiar with this report, was wondering if it really indicated relapse, or if you're familiar with this report.
New infection, yes.
It was genotyped as a Texas strain, but from a World War II vet, I guess, who lived in Texas or something like that.
Yes, actually, I don't remember how the genotype, what the genotype did reveal. But I think it was genotyped and found to be from the same location where he had gone, and not found in the location where he's lived. And he never gone back there. So it was sort of like the World War II vets and the Strongyloides story, if you remember.
Right.
That just by epidemiology, they assumed that they concluded that there had been no exposure between the time when they were in the endemic region.
So maybe, maybe you could talk about the reservoirs or the presumed reservoirs for this relapse phenomenon.
Yes. So you mean within the host?
In the host. Sorry. Yes.
So this is interesting because the prostate and the eye. And some would say even maybe not the brain, but anyway, prostate and the eye for sure are immunologically protected sites. So any organism that can get in there can potentially stay safe from the host immune response. And that is presumably why there's persistence of organisms in those organs. So the other examples of this would be most recently and most dramatically was the Ebola persistence in the prostate and sexual transmission years after recovery. Other good examples of this would be another good example. Elise, can you think of
another Zika? Zika have a
Zika is another one. That's a good one. Yeah. So basically, persistence in the host reservoir probably occurs in immunologically protected organs, and that's if the organism can persist in a dormant state in those organs, it can you can get long-term carriage and reservoir formation.
I see. Yeah. So the lymph nodes really don't play a role, it sounds like, in harboring organisms that probably reactivate later.
No, not that I'm aware of.
Okay. And because I know you mentioned it sounds like a skeletal survey on all the patients and.
No, I'm sorry. Maybe I gave the wrong impression. We don't do a skeletal survey unless there's some symptoms or some indication for localizing it to the bone. In that particular case, because it was over his shin, we were concerned about involvement.
Oh, I see. Sorry, I misunderstood.
Sorry, I was not clear in my delivery.
Do you mostly target your workup with the symptoms, not necessarily pan scanning everybody?
That's true. The only ones that we do scan the lung and the abdomen, because those can be silent.
I see. Okay, that's helpful.
And they're commonly enough involved to be worth looking for.
Sure. Okay. And I don't know if you can speak to this, but there was a question about if the treatment for Burkholderia mallei and pseudomallei are different. So glanders versus melioidosis, is there?
So my experience, I don't have know the actual answer to that. But my understanding is that they both respond to the same treatment. In terms of treatment, there's no difference. Mallei.
Do you guys see glanders much? It's very rare, I think, in humans in general.
It's very rare. Glanders is much more common in Europe and in Asia and Africa. In the Australian scene, they don't see glanders. I've never seen a glanders case. I've never heard of glanders being a problem in the animal populations here.
And so the next question is there any difference in typical clinical presentation depending on the geographic region of acquisition?
That's a good question. Generally the Southeast Asian cases that we see tend to be more invasive, more commonly invasive. Mm. The Australian cases are about half of the proportion are invasive compared to the Southeast Asian cases. So there probably are strain differences in terms of the toxins that they produce or the cofactors that are produced that allow them to invade deeper. And why kava use was
And then this is from Adrian. Yeah, well, curious as to why kava use was examined as a risk factor in the first study from Australia.
I don't know. That's a good question. I can look it up and I'll send you the answer and you can distribute it amongst the people, the attendees.
Ruling that out as cause. And then I think, and then someone posted, I think, one of the links.
The Walmart.
A link to the one of the reports from Georgia Walmart, the aromatherapy cases you mentioned. Yes. So if people want to check that out, it's in the chat. And Scott Norton writes that bioterrorism, melioidosis is listed as a potential agent of bioterrorism. How would the pathogen theoretically be distributed? And would treatment for weaponized pathogens be any different from
that's a very good question. And actually that's so melioidosis, Burkholderia pseudomallei is a tier one bioweapon, dual use agent, considered a tier one agent, primarily because it can cause severe disease. It's treatable, but it can cause severe disease and it's difficult to recognize. And there's a possible acquisition through aerosol. It happens to be that the aerosol acquisition is very much less common than skin percutaneous acquisition, but it's possible to get it by aerosol. And that's why, I believe, is why it's been listed as bioterrorism. Now, in terms of treatment, there wouldn't be any difference in the treatment of the weaponized pathogens than the normal pathogen. But in terms of how it will be distributed, that's a good question. Theoretically, you could, because it's acquired from the environment, you could spread it around in the environment, in a room or in a
just house, right?
Wherever you could spread it around, and the acquisition through the skin might be sufficient to cause secondary infections. But person-to-person transmission has not really been reported, except in rare cases. It's not transmitted person to person. It's environment to person. So it would have to be distributed through the environment.
Can I add one more question on the back of that one, that if you suspect a case of melioidosis, do you have to warn the microbiology lab?
Yes, that's a very good point, Brooke. The risk is highest to the lab people who work with it because of the risk of aerosolization. So we do definitely have to put an alert on the request form, Burkholderia risk or some indicating that there's a risk for them.
I might just squeeze in maybe one more question for myself, since we have a minute. In terms of those predictions about the changing epidemiology in the future, I was just curious if most of that was based off of, because it does seem to be very related to rainfall and water, if that's based on changes in rainfall predictions or temperature or other things.
I think you're absolutely right. They will totally coincide with the predictions of increased rainfall or increased temperature in areas which are not, at this time, lower in rainfall. So I think that the model, at least the ones that Simon Hay has published, essentially parallels the rainfall and temperature rise. The spread of the range parallels that.
Gotcha. One other, and Preston Hawley just notes that, returning to the bioterrorism question, it could also undergo in vitro mutations for antibiotic resistance to weaponize it, I suppose.
Yes.
That's another thought. Well, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate all of the discussion. We, you know, I never hear about it anyway, and I think it's, you know, quite rare, as evidenced by the fact that 2 out of those 4 cases in the U.S. died. I'm sure most people don't think about it. So thank you. And this will be posted on our little YouTube channel at some point in the near future. And if anybody has any other questions, of course, I'm sure they can direct them towards our email address and we could forward them to you. But very, very interesting topic indeed. Thanks so much, sir. Really appreciate
it. Thank you for having me. It was a real pleasure. And I'll be happy to answer. And if you forward me any questions, I'll be happy to respond directly.
Okay. All right.